This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
Why don't you take you back to 2009, Road to the Horse, the great colt starting competition. Over the course of that weekend, all of us did a lot of interviews with media from several different countries. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb here for the Horse Show. One of the questions posed to me was from a French reporter who was very in tune with the American natural horsemanship movement. And basically her question was, how can we get the people in Europe, France in particular, to really notice this, to sit up and take notice of it? Well, of course, there are some people in Europe that are practicing this, but not as many as we would like. And she was particularly interested in the dressage and jumping and, you know, kind of this quote-unquote English riding world. And we talked for several minutes about various ideas. And then I hit on the idea that, you know, if there was somebody that they really respected that was at the top of his or her game in, say, dressage and was an advocate of these principles, that person could probably do far more than she or I could do to making this seem legitimate to those people, at least to get them to take a look at it. That's all we ever asked. And in the course of this conversation, Dr. Robert Miller sat down beside us and he said, well, you know, there's a guy that, you know, does a lot of work with the Pirellis that is a very famous dressage master. And it clicked and I remembered who they were talking about, the great Walter Zettl. And it just so happened that I interviewed him in 2004 at the Western States Horse Expo. Marvelous interview about how dressage and natural horsemanship are so entirely compatible. Well, I'm bringing that back to you today. I hope you enjoy it. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show, and we'll be back. Stay with us.
EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit Protozil.com. That's Protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information.
Jeffers is the best equine catalog with more than 25,000 items, same day free shipping, and the lowest prices guaranteed. Jeffers has equine blankets in a wide range of sizes and weights to fit any horse from a mini to a draft. Mention the Horse Show and get a $10 Jeffers gift card to use with a future order. That's a $10 gift card when you buy a blanket and mention the Horse Show. Call 1-800-JEFFERS or visit jefferseequine.com. Jeffers Equine, earning your trust right here in America since 1975.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you.
Red Brand Fence welcomes you to visit our new online store called redbrandstore.com. There you can purchase Red Brand Fence, installation tools, and a wide selection of Red Brand clothing and accessories. Ordering is easy, and items are shipped directly to your home, including fence. There's also special offers and seasonal promotions. And for a limited time, listeners of The Horse Show can receive 10% off your first order of fence, clothing, or tools. To receive your discount, go to redbrandstore.com and enter promo code HORSESHOW10.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition. Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need. Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's growstrong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Imagine this. Your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with a lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com. And while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again.
And now, back to the Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
From Sacramento, California, this is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Wall Clippers. I'm Rick Lamb. My guest in this segment of our program is Mr. Walter Zettl. Mr. Zettl, welcome to the Horse Show.
Rick, thank you very much. I have the opportunity to speak about my favorite sport. My whole life, I really did try to have the horses as my friend, not as my slave. But the dressage riding should be to be a partnership between the rider and the horse. It's very hard because we have to bring completely two different lives together.
Absolutely. They couldn't be more different, as a matter of fact. I like to think of it in terms of them as opposite two species as you could possibly make. The horse being the ultimate predator, or prey animal, rather, and the human being, because we can reason and plan and make tools. We are the ultimate predator. You put those two together, that's a pretty unlikely match.
Absolute. And, you know, I comparing the horse with a child in the kindergarten. When we would ask the child too much, he would get frightened. But even for the child in the kindergarten, we can speak it our language. In the dressage or in the riding, we have only our aids. And the horse can only understand us when we give the right aids, but we have to give them also in the right moment.
Talk just for a moment before, I don't want to get too far off our planned topic here, but when you talk about aids, obviously the hands and the seat and the legs, some people define a few additional ones like the voice or your focus or whatever. What do you consider the aids?
The aids are the weight aids, leg aids, and the hand aids. We are hand-oriented.
Yes, we are.
So we try everything to correct with our hands. That's nature, right? But in the riding, we should do exactly the opposite. We should forget the hand and balance the horse out with our weight and our legs.
Boy, and what a great point.
You see, the horse from nature is in balance. As soon as the horse has the saddle on or the rider, the horse is immediately out of balance. And we, through our exercise, through our tempis, through our transitions, we try to bring the horse back in balance without forcing the horse in a frame. The horse should frame himself. That means we have to engage the hind leg. So the hind leg is stepping under, the back rolls up, and the horse gives. When we have the hind leg, then we bring the horse in the automatic frame, not because we are framing with the hands. When I try to form the horse in a frame with my hands, the hind leg is not coming automatic. The hind leg stays away. Hmm. And the hind leg is the engine.
We wanted to talk today about redefining the classical approach to dressage. Give us a quick beginner's definition of dressage, and then we'll move on.
Yes. Dressage is really only everything what the horse shows in nature. We try to refine this, bring this in our control without force, so we can bring it back any second. This means we really train the horse so only this what he shows in the nature. And when the horse have the trust to you, then you will see this. All those gates he shows in Asia will be more brilliant without force. Force should not exist in the training. In the training I did learn and what I try to teach too.
That's interesting. You just said that, you know, all the natural, the gates that he would exhibit in nature, we can actually improve upon them through training?
Yes, absolute.
So it's better than natural?
Yes. No, I wouldn't say. I would say refining.
Refining.
And in...
more athletic, perhaps.
More athletic.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Gymnastic.
Gymnastic, you know? Absolutely. And then what is the classical approach to dressage? I guess compare... What is the alternative to the classical approach? The modern approach?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. What? Give us a... compare the two. Everybody here's in on this but me, I guess.
Yeah. You see, in those time when I was learning, we were a little bit outsider because we did ride our horses so every child could ride after us. You know, many of my colleagues did say, you are really idiots. You're riding the horses so everybody can ride. So it should be. But when you ride the horse so nobody else can ride, then you have a good horse and the owner pays for it. I mean, this is not really the idea for a classical training. Classical training should be a partnership, how did you say it before, and bring those two together in harmony. In a partnership, what really is built up on trust. Like in a partnership with a marriage. When you don't trust your partner, they won't really work. And the same is dressage. And in the classic dressage is no force. We do everything what the horse is showing, and every exercise we build up from an easy exercise. Like, say at once, go on a circle. Go on a 20-meter circle is the bending we need for shoulder four. That means a little bit the shoulders to the inside. We say then 10-meter circle is the bending we need for shoulder in without force. I always force is really something what makes me goosebump in a bad way.
Who do you consider historically to be your ideal as far as classical dressage is concerned? Well, is there an individual?
Well, my boss was really the one I would let cut my arms off for him. Because I was working with him, I never saw him once losing the patience.
That's amazing.
Really. And
let's go ahead and name it. Colonel Herbert W. Oust.
Oust, yes.
Oust, A-U-S-T, yeah.
Right.
How did you meet him?
Well, I came from Czechoslovakia because I had to flee because they put everybody in jail from the Russian. So you did go to West. And I was talking all the time about writing I did too at the Hitlerjugend. And then this one guy, he say, oh, I can't hear you anymore. This horses. So why don't you go in the end of the city? There is a writing facility where the American are writing. And the German officer is giving the lessons there. And maybe they're looking for somebody. Start out with a groom. That's what I did. So I did, when I came in, I tell you, he was standing in a leather coat, very far, polished boots, you know, spurs underneath. I say, brother, standing up straight.
You wanted that, huh?
Yeah,
you thought that looked pretty
right.
Good.
This was the first impression. I say, so I like to be.
My guest is Mr. Walter Zettl. This is The Horse Show Live, brought to you by Wall Clippers from the Western States Horse Expo. We'll continue in just a moment talking about redefining the classical approach to dressage. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pen. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pen. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels.
And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel in Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com.
From the Western States Horse Expo, this is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Wall Clippers. I'm Rick Lamb. My guest is Walter Zettl. Mr. Zettl, we were just talking about your mentor, Colonel Oust. He had brought forward all of these principles of kind of resistance-free or non-violent or non-forceful types training. He brought that forward from the masters of previous, you know,
Absolute.
Centuries,
right.
Who still had at their core some fairly coercive techniques, even though they were starting to move more and more towards a psychological approach. He had kind of perfected that, it sounds like.
Absolute. He always did explain us the nature of the horse is so important in our training. We not have to kill this nature instinct, like when the horse is fleeing. Yeah. We have to work with this to give this schwung into the work. So his whole attitude was always let the horse work with us in his nature instinct.
See, that is so in tune with what's happening in America right now in this whole quote-unquote natural horsemanship movement. It's all about using the horse's nature instead of fighting it, trying to see the world through his eyes, using the things that are important to him to motivate him. How was that received at that time in Europe?
When we be a professional teacher, we have to work 3 years under a professional teacher, and then you have to have an exam. And when you like to be then a professional teacher, you have to work 2 more years under supervising of a professional teacher. And everybody in this test you have to go through have to be written exactly how I teach. But soon as this young trainer or the berater, they did get then in their own place. And then they did start the success pressure. And then they get cutter, shorter. They try to go quicker to the results. And then they start what we have many times now, the force.
So shortcutting. It sounds to me like what you're saying, when time becomes of the essence in getting the job done quickly,
right.
The horse force is a natural byproduct of that.
Absolutely.
Of worrying about the time it takes.
Yeah. You see, they are in a sense of pressure to have quick success. Then they don't really deck the horse anymore as a partner. They're making slave. They do everything.
Too much focused on maybe the end result rather than the process, it sounds
right.
Like, wanting to get there.
Absolutely.
I wanted to bring up this idea before we run out of time today of short and deep, what you called a violation of our horses versus long and low, and get you to explain, first of all, what the difference between those are, and can they both be part of training, just maybe different stages, or are you totally against the idea of short and deep?
Absolutely against.
Okay, let's explain, first of all, what those two mean.
You see, in the classic dressage, we work in partnership. And that give the horse enough time to develop all the muscles, the tendons, and knees least needing 1 year. to develop the right muscles, to get strong with his ankles. And in the shortcut, low and deep, this is then where the force comes. They're forming the horse in the frame with trowel reins or whatever, and don't really recognize it enough how sensitive the horse's mouth is. The most sensitive part of the horse is the mouth. And how, when you see this, how they work on this mouth around. Put him a big bit in the mouth so the horse gives around. They form the horse. They do everything because they're slaves, but not brilliance. They're losing completely the brilliance and the charm. And also all the gates, they are tight, tense. In the classical dressage, is really the gates smooth. Every transition are very, very one gliding into the other without force. And this is really, that's why I'm really absolute against this forcing.
So how do you obtain collection, which is so important in dressage, without going that route?
You see, now we have to, now again, those two classes. The classical dressage is engaging the hind leg without holding or form the horse with the hands. The horse should form himself through the hind leg, and the hands is only there to catch this. Without in the low and deep is really forming the horse too much with the hands and driving too much. Also, the classic dressage riding, because it doesn't create force, this is then where the horse, any type of horses, if it is a small horse, a big horse, thoroughbred horse, temperament, the horse will take this. Every child can ride. So we say half pound weight in the front and 1.5 pound weight driving. This every horse will take, every rider can do. But soon as I have too much in my hand, I have to drive too much, and then the horse gets excited, they get frightened. Many horses, they quit, they lay down, they don't go up. They say, you can kill me, but I don't do this stuff, what you do. But those are the smart horses, not those horses. They started to be a slave for this rider. And this what is the really the difference?
What are you doing actually then with your hands? Obviously, you don't want to pull back on
That's
the horse's
right.
mouth. That's, I think everybody can understand that. But at the bare minimum, I would expect that you'd want to set your hands and kind of create
right.
a wall in effect in front, but not pulling back, just creating a sort of a limit, saying you cannot move past this point.
Limit. I didn't like this word.
I was okay until I said limit.
Well, really, it hurt me.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, but how would you do it then?
No, you see, with the hands, we should work always forwards without losing the contact. And this is what I create in the back, I receive in the front without pulling back.
Now that right there was a very important thing. I hope you got that, folks. Think about that. We'll be back in just a moment with more from Walter Zettl. This is the Horse Show live from the Western States Horse Expo, brought to you by Wall Clippers. I'm Rick Lamb. We'll be back. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels.
And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel in Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
Thank you, Windman. We are back, everybody, at the Western States Horse Expo. This is The Horse Show Live, brought to you by Wall Clippers. My guest is dressage master Walter Zettl. We're just talking about the use of the hands. Okay, I'm still unclear what you're actually doing with your hands. Can you just say how you would teach the use of the hands?
The hands should stay always still and working forwards. So I should be able to go in an extended canter. I press my heels down, my will say stop, go forwards with the hands, and the horse stops, not backwards.
So you're maintaining a presence on the horse's mouth and kind of following his movement, but always with that presence so that he knows you're there and he can sense your will through your hands.
Right.
Without it pulling, or without setting a limit, as we said before.
I always say, open up the door. Open up the door so the horse really can go through. When I shut the door, what you did say before, wall, then the horse runs a couple times in, and then he backs up. The same with us when we go in a dark room, and we run a couple times with a nose in the wall, we back up. The same with the horse. And as soon as the horse backs up, I'm losing the schwung. I'm losing the power from the back.
Right. If he's getting behind the bit like that, then your tendency would be to pull back a little bit more so you get him back on the bit, and it's just an ever-escalating thing, it sounds
like. Absolutely. Absolutely. You see many times the horse goes far behind the bit. The horse stops through this. The shoulder can reach forwards, so he goes up and down. So the landing is very hard for the horses on the ground. So that goes on the hoofs, goes on the tendons, goes on the ankles, and on the back. So you hardly can sit anymore on these poor horses. And what he's really doing, everybody says, oh, my horse is on the bit. He is behind the bit. That's what means he escaping my aids. He not listen to my aids. I have to start more and more aids, stronger aids. And then it's this vicious circle. I halt in the front and drive, but the horse don't go forwards because the wall is there where he runs in.
So it sounds like the converse of that would be then the better you train him, the less...
strength you need.
The less you need to use the aids. I mean, the Absolutely. More subtle they can become.
You see, my boss always did say, the less aids you see, the better you are, the better the horse will react, the stronger, and we, most of the time, we give two strong aids.
Yeah, and that's true, I think, of any good riding. Really good riders, you cannot even see them communicating with
Absolutely.
The horse. So much of it is happening through the seat and the seat bones, which is difficult for us to see. But certainly, there's not a lot of activity with the hands and even with the feet.
It's Absolutely.
Subtle.
Absolutely. The less aids we see, the better the horse will react. We really kill our aids because we are so strong with the aids. You have to go more and more. That's why you see then these big spurs, those long whips. I'm so happy now they don't allow those long whips anymore. God thanks. That's why always the same when you're starting then. Say it this way. In the classic dressage, you're starting slowly, step for step, and go exactly through those six elements of the dressage, of the classical dressage.
This is all great. I wanted to cover a couple other things before we run out of time here. I wanted to ask you, you've spent your whole life doing this, how would you like to be remembered by the horse world? What is your place in history, do you think?
When I am remembered of to my horses, he was very kind with always with his aides. He did try to build up a relationship, and we could see in a very short time through the kindness between what he tried to create between the rider and horse is a partnership and not a slave and master thing. Then I'm happy, and I go happy up in heaven.
Are you okay with the leader and follower aspect?
Yes. Okay. The leader...
Or again, senior partner and junior partner.
Right. I'm always a little bit afraid, master and
slave.
So always when I create a partnership without any force, you know, and this is for me happiness. That's why really I did write those books. I did make those videotapes. I have such a respect for you here in North America, because how hard it is for you to learn this wonderful dressage. I tell you, dressage is wonderful. To be together with a horse in almost in one piece.
And we spoke about this before we did this interview. I was asking you about the difference between dressage in America or North America and in Europe, and your response was that they have so much access to dressage teachers in Europe. Nobody has to even, you know, travel very far to get it. But here in America, people have to really want it, and they drive great distances, travel great distances to get it, which speaks well for them.
And spending so much money, time. You know, I get always goosebumps when writers coming in our clinic and they say, where you come from? Oh, we say, only 5 hours.
See, in Europe, it'd take you halfway across the continent.
You in 8 hours, you're from South Germany in North Germany.
Yeah.
And between this, you have at least 1,000 places where you can stop and ride.
Yeah. I'm going to come to the audience here and ask some take your questions for Mr. Zettl. While I'm getting out there, the question I'd like you to address is just the future of dressage and the future of horsemanship in general. Are you optimistic about that? How do you see the future?
I'm a little bit afraid because, you know, those shortcut riding brings very quick success to the riders. But when they ever did see a horse and did feel a horse, what that means is a partnership between. You never could ride different, never. And this is really what we try to keep continue, and this will be harder and harder. Because too much those quick success, what goes of cost to the horse. The horse is really the poor guy who have to pay the bill.
You know, we talk about time being such a key factor for most modern people, and that's part of the problem. How long, and I know it's different for every horse, but in general, how long should people figure it's going to take to train a dressage horse?
To train a dressage horse from the beginning until the Grand Prix would have a very talented horse, a very talented rider, very talented teachers on the ground. Next you 4 years that the horse goes all movements for Grand Prix.
You know, that's quicker than I thought you were going to say.
No. And then takes 1 more year to get everything together in test form.
Okay.
You know, so that means 5 years. But those 5 years counts only when you have really...
You're working on it all the
super
time.
Super horse,
yeah.
Super rider, super teacher, and every day. Now, I say also something. Not only everyday dressage, you have to go into the country with the horse. Jump. Our horses did jump and go dressage. I had horses that did go to Grand Prix jumping and dressage on the show, not only at home. It's wonderful, I tell you. You know, between the changes, between the jumps, you go one tempi and jump. On the next, you go piaf or passage and jump. Everybody say, oh, that's nice. But you see...
Well, you keep the horse interested.
Not mechanical.
Yeah.
You know, the horse should really be still a horse. Don't teach the horse every day the same. Go out, go jump, go cabaletti work, but don't make your horses machines.
Well, so many horses that are just worked in an arena get arena sour, and you know that's
absolute.
And then
absolute.
You get them out on a trail, and any little distraction causes them to come apart.
That's right. They get in panic.
All right. Well, the time has come for us to take questions from the audience. This is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Wall Clippers from the Western States Horse Expo in Sacramento. My guest is Mr. Walter Zettl. The subject is dressage. Don't go away.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD-TV.
RFD-TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD-TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
Imagine this. Your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with the lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com. And while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition. Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need. Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's growstrong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Jeffers is the best equine catalog with more than 25,000 items, same-day free shipping, and the lowest prices guaranteed. Jeffers has equine blankets in a wide range of sizes and weights to fit any horse from a mini to a draft. Mention the Horse Show and get a $10 Jeffers gift card to use with a future order. That's a $10 gift card when you buy a blanket and mention the Horse Show. Call 1-800-JEFFERS or visit jefferseequine.com. Jeffers Equine, earning your trust right here in America since 1975. EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit Protozil.com. That's Protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information. The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
Now, you will never have an easier job in your entire life, folks, but it's a very important one. Just tell people about The Horse Show. That's how our program grows. That's how you can do your part to make sure that we're still here next year at this time. From the Western States Horse Expo, this is The Horse Show Live, brought to you by Wall Clippers. My guest is Walter Zettl, and it is time for questions from the audience. Yes, ma'am.
This is a very elementary question. I just went to my very first dressage show the other day, and in some ways, it looked cruel. And how can I tell the difference between when a horse is partnershipping with its owner and when the owner is trying to strong arm the horse and actually being cruel with the horse? Because when the head is pulled in so much, it doesn't look natural. And so how can I tell when it's kind and it's art and when it's cruelty?
Yeah, you see, this is so a great question. I don't go anymore to the shows because what I see on these shows, on the warm-up, and even inside, is so cruel. With the boar horse, they ride more backwards than forwards, and every brilliance they take away from the horse. Every brilliance. You know, they forget completely as should be an art. Dressage, the classic dressage, is art. Like in every art, it should be harmony. That's why I'm writing it, dressage in harmony. Art. And everything else, you know, I saw it on show, they came out. First of all, they did get disqualified because they were so cruel on the warm-up. I wish they keep really doing this. Then one rider came out of the ring with a gray horse, he was bleeding on both sides. Is this dressage? I say this is butchering.
You know, to address her question, if it doesn't look like art, it's not.
It's not.
So if you had that question in your mind, there was a reason for that.
You see, everybody sees this. You know, they see, oh, this is wonderful. This is art. This is the classical. But when you have a little bit of tout, I say, God, this I wouldn't do to my horse. This is then what you have to forget.
Yeah, the idea of dressage as art is certainly not a modern concept. I mean, this was something practiced several hundred years ago, from the 1500s, from the Renaissance forward. I mean, they used art as the proper training of young gentlemen, you know,
and fencing and
dancing and dressage. I mean, all kinds of things like that.
Very good, Ricky, you say that. You see, my boss did... She sent us to dance course. They say when you are a good dancer, then you can go with emotion with your horse. When you would jerk your partner around and be stiff, the next time when you ask him to dance with you, he say, I'm sorry, I have a little bit back aching, or I have to go to the washroom. When you have a partner, he's really... He doesn't have to look good, you know, but when he's dancing, you can forget everything. Motion.
Huh? Oh, that's great. Who else has a question for Walter Zettl? We'll go to the back here.
I have a new horse that has been lightly raced. Do I have any hope with
him? Oh, yes. That's very good you come up there. I'm a lady, you're not old, right? But I just like to say Also, all tours, I'd like to tell you a little bit about a wonderful stallion I did get in training. He was 18 years old, and the owner did say, you know, my horse never did learn one tempo changes. So that means, you know, those fancy, I don't like it anyway. You know, because that's unnature. It's circus. But they're asking in the shows, and so we have to train this. The first thing, I had to learn the poor horse to canter. After 18 years, he had to learn canter. Because he couldn't make the changes because he didn't canter correct. He had absolute four-beat canter. And then, of course, he came to, and he was 19 years. You could go around 100 one tempis. So you can see one is never too old to learn.
We have an anonymous question here. What age do you start horses?
We never did start the horses at 3.5, never before. We were even waiting 4 years. But now I must remember when I was on the championship in Warndorf, they had so wonderful horses when they come out. And then when I came to the warm-up, I saw this very framed the horse in, very tight. And then I asked this guy, I say, why are you doing this? Why are you so strong with the horse? You're sitting in too heavy. The horse is three years, and he's already going like a Grand Prix horse. And then he said, well, you in your age, you know, you didn't have the good horses. I say, yes, we didn't have good horses. We had all those horses that were left over from the war. And with this, we threw our classic riding, the horses did look brilliant. You know, it's also something. You don't have bad horses or good horses. You have only bad riders and good riders. We create the horse. Is the horse good, then you're good. Is the horse bad, then you're bad. Huh? So we are creating the horse. Same when I'm teaching, I never blame my rider or my horse. I always blame me. I say, what did I do wrong? Yeah. When a horse do something wrong, then he don't do it on purpose. One of my students came, oh, he did it on purpose. I say, you idiot. How can a horse, he's not so smart, you know, and so tricky than we, and do a mistake on purpose? He do a mistake because he misunderstands your aids. You give the aids in the wrong moment. He didn't understand either. How should the poor horse understand? Or we did ask something what he can't do yet in the training.
Yeah, it's never the horse's fault. That's kind of the bottom line on that. We have a question right here, ma'am.
Yes, it's a wonderful to listen to you. For one thing, I love your accent.
Oh, thank you very much. I was afraid you don't understand my English.
No, you do very well, believe me.
Thank you, very kind.
Usually when we come to these realizations about the gentleness, it's a process, a personal process. Can you bring us up to date kind of how you transitioned into this gentleness and this relationship?
You see, my boss did say, just write so what you try to be treated yourself. So when you have somebody who's always squeezing you and squeezing you, then you're starting to resist. And that's why my boss and me too now, I always say, please try to get in connection with your horse. Try to build up a partnership, not a slave and master. Does this answer your question? Or?
You know, obviously you had, your mentor had a huge impact on your life.
Oh, yes.
In general, do you think that's the way to go, to find some individual, a teacher, stay with that teacher, try and learn as much as you can, as opposed to getting this broad-based education?
Yeah. You see, that's also how I feel very sorry for you and your horses. You can only, when you're lucky and have a trainer on your place, will be very nice to him and stay with him. What makes it so hard, because you have to learn only through clinic. So you go, now we say, you go to a clinic where I am. I say, soft, open up the door. Don't drive so much. Be soft with the hands. Don't use too strong aids because we killed the aids. The next time a clinician comes, he's not too sure himself. You know, he say, oh, that's what you did learn from the guy before. It's terrible. You have to ride much stronger. You have to be really a little bit tough because look, the strong horse. Huh? That's the second time. Now, because you believe then, this is the right thing to do. So when the next comes, starts again, different. So you have, in a very short time, three different styles. So that means you and the horse did get completely upset. Huh? And after a while you say, oh, when this is dressage, then I ride in the cross country, so nobody can see me. Yeah, really.
So a good idea to find somebody that you really believe in. Show them your video there also. This is for sale at, I believe you have a booth here, do you not?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Tell them about your video.
This one is almost 2 hours, so you better have time. Huh? And this is then the second and the third and the fourth comes. And this is where we start then the collection to make get the horse know what collection starts. Here in the first one shows the horse the history and so on and so on.
Well, sir, you are one of the most special people I have ever talked to on my radio show, and I appreciate
Very
you
kind.
Doing this for us. Ladies and gentlemen, please give a hand to Mr. Walter Zettl.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you all for coming, and I hope you enjoy your day at the Western States Horse Expo.
Thank you.
And thanks again to Walt Clippers for sponsoring our trip to the Western States Horse Expo. You know, there were several quotes that I found of Mr. Zettl's in preparing for this interview that I didn't have a chance to ask him about, but I do want to pass them on to you because I think they're definitely food for thought. He says he wants riders to have complete sympathy for the horse and devotion to its happiness and well-being. He wants them to make their horses happy, confident, and proud to work for them. Force and battling have no place in his training method. And he also says this, dressage does not mean total submission of the horse. He's definitely of a similar mind to the whole natural horsemanship movement we talk about so much on this show, the revolution in horsemanship, the idea of seeing the world through the horse's eyes, having empathy for another creature. Mr. Walter Zettl, certainly a very special man and a very important man in the world of dressage. For more information, check the internet search engine under Zettl, Z-E-T-T-L. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.